right. Good evening, everyone. My name is Robert Hayes. I'm the Community Outreach Librarian and Head of Technical Services at the Tewksbury Public Library. We're going to wait about 30 seconds or so to make sure everyone comes in from the waiting room before we start with formal introductions. So we'll just give it another 20 seconds or so. While we wait, for those who are comfortable doing so, no obligation, but no pressure. But just to kill the next 15 seconds or so, let us know in the chat where you're joining us from tonight. So if you're comfortable doing so, let us know what city or town you are attending from. Attending from? Sure. Right off the bat, Rhode Island, Canton, Tewksbury, Amherst, New Hampshire. Wonderful. All right, well, hopefully everyone who plans on attending is here. We have a pretty good turnout. Tewksbury, Boston, Phoenix, Arizona, Boston. Wonderful. All right, great. Well, as I mentioned, my name is Robert Hayes, Community Outreach Librarian and Head of Technical Services at the Tewksbury Public Library. I want to thank my counterpart over at the Memorial Hall Library in Andover, Stephanie Traina, for partnering with us for tonight's program. A couple of logistical things. I am recording tonight's presentation. We're also streaming live to the Tewksbury Library's Facebook page. We are recording. Just know we are in Zoom webinar mode, so the cameras aren't going to capture your video. We cannot see you. We cannot hear you. If you want to communicate with Frank, you're going to want to type comments into the comment section and Q&A into the Q&A section, and we will address any comments and questions at the end of the presentation. I anticipate the program, including questions, lasting no more than 90 minutes. We'll probably get you out of here a little bit before 8:30. Want to thank the Friends of the Tewksbury Library and Friends of the Memorial Hall Library for co-sponsoring tonight's event. And just a note that I'll be sending an email to everyone who registered on Zoom tomorrow with a link to a feedback survey. Please take 30, 60 seconds, fill out that survey. Let us know what you thought of tonight's event and what you'd like to see for future events here at the Tewksbury Library and the Andover Library. All right, let's get to the good stuff here. So tonight's presentation is entitled Academy Awards, The Good, The Bad, and The Outrageous. How did the annual Academy Awards get started? Why was it created, and who exactly votes? Who has won and lost the award over the years? What are some famous and infamous moments from the ceremony itself? And of course, who are this year's nominees in a very different looking award season? Come join Frank Mandosa to brush up on your Oscar knowledge for the biggest night of the year in Hollywood. So Frank Mandosa is a full-time Massachusetts high school film and English teacher. He has been giving film lectures at libraries, senior centers, and community centers across the state since 2012. Frank is the co-host of Real Life, R-E-E-L, Real Life, get it, an award-winning local access TV show that features movie reviews. So all, 35 of our so that are currently here live on Zoom, and another half dozen or so that are watching live on Facebook. And then for everyone that's gonna watch on demand on YouTube, let's give a big virtual round of applause to Frank for joining us here tonight. And Frank, you can take it away. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming here tonight. I really appreciate it. And I'm taking a look here in the chat. Looks like we have people from a lot of different places. And someone says, those of us who are film buffs can't get enough. And I can tell you, I completely wholeheartedly agree with that sentiment, because this may have been, the past 12, 13 months may have been difficult for us, for everybody in different ways. But anytime there is a chance to be able to just experience a little bit of enjoyment, a little bit of a welcome relief from the trials of everyday life, I say chase after life's enjoyments. And for me personally, and presumably for you as well, the movies are one of those sources of enjoyment. So That's why we're here tonight, to celebrate the annual Academy Awards ceremony. So I'd like to begin by acknowledging and thanking the Tewksbury Library, the Memorial Hall Library, the Friends of the Tewksbury Library, and of course, Robert Hayes for having me back. My name is Frank Mandosa, and I don't need to repeat anything that Robert just said, but I can tell you that if you would like to follow me on social media, I have all of my information pertaining to the socials here on the page, and feel free to follow me on Twitter at filmbuff1974, on Instagram at frankmandosa1974, and on Facebook. If you're on Facebook, I do have a film page that I created about six, 7 years ago, and it's called Silver Screeners. So it's a public page, so please feel free to spread the word. The more the merrier. I'd love to have fellow film buffs on all three of these socials to share ideas and to relax and enjoy. And I also would like to tell you that I am days away from launching a new podcast, a film-themed podcast. And to keep it simple, it's actually going to have the same title as my Facebook film page. So it will be Silver Screeners. And if you're interested, just follow me on any or all of my socials, and you'll be seeing me pushing out the link to the premiere episode of Silver Screeners coming up in hopefully over the next few days. So let's dive right into tonight's topic, the Academy Awards, the good, the bad, and the outrageous. And let's begin by taking a look at the 8 Best Picture nominees. Now, some of you may have attended last week's program with Boston Globe film critic Ty Burr, so I'm not looking to tread too much into his previously covered territory here. So I'm not going to be showing you any of the trailers from this year's nominees. I do have here, however, a collage of the posters of all eight of the best picture candidates. We have The Father, Judas and the Black Messiah, Mank, Minari, Trial of the Chicago 7, Sound of Metal, Promising Young Woman, and Nomadland. And for the record, of course, now that I say this, I'm really committing myself, but for the record, my sneaking suspicion is that Nomadland is going to be the one to go home with the gold. And to make it more convenient for you, I also included here some updated information as far as where you're able to find these Best Picture nominees, where you're able to stream them from or rent them from. So feel free to take a screenshot. And some of them are on Netflix, some on Amazon Prime, some available to rent on iTunes and Amazon Prime and Hulu and streaming services like that. I can tell you that Promising Young Woman I recently got on DVD, I rented from a Redbox kiosk. So if that's something that you haven't done in a while in this age of streaming, just a friendly reminder that that is still an option that's cheap and affordable that's out there. And Promising Young Woman is available on disc at a Redbox kiosk. All right, I'm gonna ask you all to go into the chat and to type in your guess here. I have a couple of interactive trivia questions here that hopefully will basically set the right tone to make this good and interactive. Who would you say out of these 5 names is the person to have hosted the Oscars the most number of times? And I'm seeing 2 guesses in the chat so far for Bob Hope. Make that 3. I'm seeing 1 for Johnny Carson. Bob Hope. 1 for Billy Crystal. 2 for Billy Crystal. Okay, well, I can say another for Billy Crystal. Another for Bob Hope. Well, I'll give you the answer now. The host who has the highest number of tally marks is Bob Hope. Bob Hope hosted the Academy Awards a staggering 18 times, radio and television combined, between 1940 and 1978. And I have here a funny little GIF that I decided to throw in to give the slides a little bit of extra life. Just poking fun at Hollywood politics and how there's competition among all the candidates. Now, of course, it's a wisecrack, so I would venture to guess that it's not always quite as cold-blooded as Bob Hope jokingly made it out to be. By contrast, Billy Crystal does hold the record for the second highest of hosting gigs at 9, Johnny Carson at 5, Whoopi Goldberg at 4, Jimmy Kimmel at 2. Also in the 2-time hosting club, we have Chris Rock, John Stewart and Ellen DeGeneres. I don't have them here on this on your screen, but I thought I'd give them a little shout out as well. All right. I do have here a little piece of trivia for you. If Frances McDormand, currently up for Nomadland, if Frances McDormand wins on Sunday night the Academy Award, that will make a total of 3 Oscars for her. She won previously for both Fargo and 3 Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. Now, if she does win on Sunday night, then she will join a very small, very elite group of actors who can boast of having won more than twice. Generally speaking, the rule of thumb is that once you have won 2 Academy Awards, I speak only of the acting branch, but the unwritten rule is that 2 tends to be the max. That's not always the case, as you can see here. Meryl Streep, Ingrid Bergman, and Katherine Hepburn, Walter Brennan, Jack Nicholson, and Daniel Day-Lewis. Each of them has 3 or more. Daniel Day-Lewis and Katherine Hepburn, I should point out, if we're talking really top tier, the two of them hold the record for having all of their Oscar wins, all of them be in the leading category. No supporting wins. I don't think there is anything less about a supporting win, but I guess if we're talking in terms of Academy Award hierarchy, the leading trophy is the one that's the highly coveted one. Even Meryl Streep and Jack Nicholson, for each of them, one of their Oscar wins was in the supporting category. Again, I don't think it's anything less, but speaking strictly in terms of the Oscars hierarchy. Now, I do have here another trivia question for you regarding this year's nominees. Leslie Odom Jr., he is nominated in 2 different categories this year, Best Supporting Actor and Best Original Song for the same film, One Night in Miami. He is the 4th person to be nominated in the same year in these 2 categories, in an acting category and a song category. Who would you say out of these 4 is the first to be nominated in the same year for the same film for both acting and songwriting? Same year, same film. And I'm seeing mostly for Barbara Streisand, 1 for Mary J. Blige, 1 for Cher. Another for Barbara Streisand, 2 more for Barbara Streisand. Well, time for the big reveal. You might be surprised, but this actually did not occur until 4 years ago. Mary J. Blige, in fact, is the first. Mary J. Blige was nominated for 2017's Mudbound in both the supporting actress and the original song categories. The following year, 2018, Lady Gaga repeated that same feat for Star is Born. She was nominated for leading actress and she won for the song Shallow. And then Cynthia Erivo last year for the film Harriet. She was nominated for leading actress and nominated for best original song for Harriet. So Leslie Odom Jr., he is the first male and the 4th in line, 4th consecutive year actually to achieve this feat. Lakeith Stanfield and Daniel Kaluuya, both of them are nominated in the supporting actor category. How that worked out is a story for another time. Which of these pair of co-stars that I have listed here, which of these co-stars also saw themselves competing in the same category for the same film, with one of them actually winning? So 3 of these pairs were nominees with no wins. One of these pairs did have a winner. And I'm seeing a couple of guesses for Susan Sarandon and Gina Davis. I see one for Ordinary People. Another for Thelma and Louise for Susan Sarandon. One for Bugsy, Ordinary People. Well, here it is. The only winner of this bunch is Timothy Hutton for 1980's Ordinary People. He still holds the record, in fact, for being the youngest supporting actor winner ever. He won for 1980's Ordinary People for playing Conrad Jarrett. Director Robert Redford also capped the Oscar for Best Picture, for Best Director, as well as the film itself for Best Picture. Glenn Close. Again, this is a story for a whole different presentation. She is nominated for supporting for Hillbilly Elegy. She also is nominated for a Razzie for the same role. This is only the third time that an actor has been nominated for the same role for both an Oscar and a Razzie. Out of these four, who else holds this dubious distinction? An Oscar and a Razzie nominee for the same role in the same film in the same year. And I'm seeing a few A's. I'm seeing a lot of A's, actually. I'm seeing one from Marissa Tomei. And the one who, I don't know if boastfully is the right word, but the one who can say, well, yeah, I was one of them as well. It was actually Amy Irving. It was Amy Irving for Yentl. Sandra Bullock was nominated for a Razzie for the same year. In the same year, she won for The Blind Side, but it was for a different film, a film called All About Steve. Marissa Tomei was not nominated for a Razzie for My Cousin Vinny at all. For only the second time ever, we have two Black women who are both nominated in the leading actress category, leading actress. Which pair of actresses was the first both to be nominated in the leading category? And I'm seeing a number of guesses for D. I'm seeing one for A. And the correct answer is in fact D. Cicely Tyson and Diana Ross were both nominated in the same year, both in the leading actress category. As far as the other three options, Octavia Spencer won for The Help, but she won in the supporting category. Monique won for Precious, the film Precious. She also won in the supporting category. Jennifer Hudson won supporting for Dreamgirls in 2006. But Cicely Tyson and Diana Ross, again, the only pair to have been nominated together the same year in the leading category. I have Sacha Baron Cohen. He is up for two Oscars. He is in the supporting category for Trial of the Chicago 7. And he is also nominated for his adapted screenplay, Borat subsequent movie film. So he is in two different categories. However, what we have here is a list of four legends. And one of them, only one, can boast of having been nominated throughout his entire career in six different categories. So who of these four has been nominated in the most number of categories, that number being six? And I'm seeing, let's see, so far across the boards, it's Clint Eastwood and nobody else yet. Oh, we have one for Quentin Tarantino, another for Clint Eastwood. Well, I'm sorry, I want to say this nicely, but the correct one actually hasn't been guessed. It's actually George Clooney. George Clooney is in the record books because he has been nominated for six different categories, both original and adapted screenplay, supporting actor, which he won in 2005 for the film Syriana, leading actor, and for director for Good Night and Good Luck in 2005. He is also a Best Picture winner for 2012's Argo. He was one of the film's producers. Best Picture Oscars always go to the film's producers. All right, so that concludes the first portion of tonight's program, the trivia section. I would like to, as the program description that Robert read indicated, I would like to give you a little bit of the history of the Oscars, how they started, why they even exist in the first place. So I have here a quote from Humphrey Bogart's classic film noir, The Maltese Falcon, "The stuff that dreams are made of," his character Sam Spade says in The Maltese Falcon. I have that here because that's probably what a lot of Oscar nominees say about the Academy Award itself, the stuff that dreams are made of. For the record, slight tangent, yes, The Maltese Falcon in 1941 was nominated for Best Picture. However, it went that year to How Green Was My Valley. And this was the same year as Citizen Kane. Now, as far as the statuette itself, since 2015, it's been manufactured at a place in New York. The statuette itself is about 13 and a half inches tall. It's about 8.5 pounds. And I have here in these bulleted points, I have here the description of how they actually make these darn things in the first place. 3D printed, molded, cast in wax, coated in ceramic, 1600 degrees Fahrenheit, 24 karat gold. So the Academy Award itself, the statuette itself, is worth a sizable chunk of change. I mean, for us common folk, it's a sizable chunk of change. I would imagine that for a millionaire, it's a mere bag of shells, but it is worth a couple of thousand dollars, several thousand dollars. So 24 karat gold dipped into pewter, 13 and a half inches tall, 8.5 pounds. It's a sizable chunk of change for me anyway. By contrast, the Razzie Award, that same award that Glenn Close and Amy Irving have both been nominated for, the Razzie Award is worth $4.95. So just a little comparison there. Now, the statuette itself, the Academy, understandably so, wants to make sure that the statuette goes only to the person for whom it is intended. If it gets out there into the wrong hands, the concern is that it will lose some of its intrinsic value if it's sold in the black market anywhere. So they really take a lot of precautions to make sure that nobody can make fakes, replicas. So they even have it in the contract with the factory that makes them, that they're shipped out to Los Angeles for the big night, but the styrofoam that they're packed inside, the styrofoam is broken into pieces before it's thrown into the dumpster so that nobody can grab the styrofoam and have a mold that they're able to use to make some fakes. So even that, they take, they mean business. They do take it very seriously. Now, there have been some critics of the Academy Awards over the years, a lot of times by the Academy Award winners themselves. Marlon Brando, after he received his first Oscar, said, "Everybody talks like you'll go to jail if you don't win." Morgan Freeman, once he won his award for $1 Million Baby, he said in an Oscars roundtable that the ceremony is just a silly contest. And George Clooney, when he won, you can find this one on YouTube, in his acceptance speech, one of the very first things he said was, "I don't quite know how you compare art." So there have been a few, if not critics, at least some skeptics in the bunch. But there are also those who are completely and totally over the moon with joy. Here is Julia Roberts when she won her Academy Award. Dear Lord, 20 years ago, the year was 2000. Well, it was early 2001 for the 2000 Oscars. Her speech went on for a little bit of an amount of time. That year, the Academy actually had said, basically it was a bribe, although they would not call it that, but the Academy said to all the nominees that year before the ceremony, "We're really looking to keep this to keep the telecast at a decent running time. So please don't go on if you win and you get up there to the podium. And if you keep your acceptance speech under, I think they said 1 minute, then we will give you a free HD TV." Because God knows they can't afford their own, right? So Julia Roberts, she was announced as the Best Leading Actress winner. And she went up to the podium. And one of the very first things she said was, "I have a television, so I'm going to take some time up here." And that's just what she did. She does not hold the record for the longest acceptance speech ever, but she came pretty close. Okay, at long last, the origins of the Oscar. Why does it begin? Why does it exist? How did it begin and why? Take a trip with me back to the year 1926. Here you have on the screen an image of Louis B. Mayer, the second M of MGM. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. And Louis B. Mayer, he was the head of MGM. He basically, he owned Hollywood. I mean, he was a studio head, yes, but he really, he was a movie mogul. I mean, he was really at the top of the upper echelon. He was, you know, he was considered the cream of the crop in terms of just power and clout. Now, in the mid-1920s, Hollywood was going through some pretty severe transitions, and not all of them were good. For one thing, there was a concern about censorship, because the silent movies that were the big thing at this point in time, silent movies were not really held to too close of a standard in terms of acceptable content. So some of them might've gone a little bit overboard for the time in terms of on-screen violence, for example, in a gangster picture, or there might be some on-screen glimpses of nudity. So there were some people throughout the country, political groups, religious groups, social reform groups, who felt that Hollywood was really a cesspool of moral corruption. There were scandals coming out of Hollywood at the time. Again, this is a story for another time. There was the trial of silent film comedian Fatty Arbuckle. There was the murder of a film director, William Desmond Taylor, drug scandals. I mean, there was just a lot going on. Basically, long story short, the federal government threatened to step in to monitor film content. They basically turned to Hollywood and said, if you don't clean up your act, we will. We will regulate film content. That made the studio heads say, oh, no, don't do that, don't do that. We'll be good. So censorship was a big concern. You know, freedom of artistic expression versus, how we will, basically keep within the guidelines, that we've been given. So censorship. There was also a huge issue as far as technology is concerned, because talking pictures were right around the corner. The Jazz Singer would debut in 1927, and that was the first film that contained actual talking. And there was some concern about that. Our audience is gonna go for it. And if so, then we're really gonna have to market and promote this concept of talking pictures. And we're really gonna have to get on board with perfecting the technology to make it something that's viable and make it something that's good. So there was the technology piece. Last and certainly not least, there was the concern of the growing whispers throughout the film industry of unionization. There were a lot of the backstage crew, electricians and carpenters and set designers, a lot of them had recently unionized. And so Louis B. Mayer felt this is taking away some of my power. And he knew that actors and directors and screenwriters, that they might follow suit. And he wanted to basically postpone the inevitable. So what does this have to do with the Oscar? Trust me, it does. Louis B. Mayer, while all of this was going on, the censorship, the tech, the unionism, in his personal life, he wanted to have, for his wife and his family, he wanted to have a beach house built along the shores of Santa Monica, California. And so he turned to the art director of his very own studio, Cedric Gibbons, and said to him, I want you to draw up the designs for this beach house. And he turned to the studio laborers, hoping that they would do the work for him, but because they had recently unionized, he felt they were asking for too much. And he said, nope, this will not do. I have lost some of my clout. So he turns to other film studio executives in town and he said, we've got to put our heads together and come up with something here that's going to help us to retain some of our creative control. So in November of 1926, the studio basic agreement, a very bare bones contract, was put together and it was agreed upon. I mean, sitting there at the bargaining table were 9 different film studios as well as union reps, and they all signed. And again, it was all meant to try to retain some degree of creative control. He knew that this was just slapping a temporary band-aid on the problem. He knew that they would have to sooner or later come up with a more permanent quote unquote solution to this problem of unionization. So a couple of months after the studio basic agreement was signed, we're now in January of 1927, his beach house is built. Here it is, lovely. And he had just moved in and it was a Sunday afternoon in January. And he said to himself, you know what, let me host a dinner here at my new home. How is this for a very strategic guest list? A director, a producer, and an actor, the very 3 branches that he was nervous would want to unionize. So he invited them over. Predictably, dinner time conversation turned to work-related issues, and together they put their heads together and said, okay, so we have all of these issues going on around Hollywood, the censorship, the tech, and the unions. What can we do to make everybody happy? And the idea that was suggested, what if there is a single organization to represent all of us. And it can have all of these different, this one organization can have all of these different subcommittees, and each subcommittee can handle a different issue. We can have a subcommittee to deal with the censorship. We can have a subcommittee to deal with the technology, and so on and so forth. And my friends, that is the birth of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. Took a few months, but by that May, about 4 months later, the state of California gave it nonprofit status. They gave it its charter. And 1 week later, Louis B. Mayer paid himself for a banquet they threw at the Biltmore Hotel, the sort of inaugural banquet, if you will. And the first president of the Academy, actor, silent film actor, Douglas Fairbanks Sr. And Douglas Fairbanks Sr., he had some previous experience with, you know, talking to crowds and being persuasive. He had a very successful run the previous decade selling bonds during the war years. So he was the first president of the Academy, and he spoke that evening at this banquet. And he was very good at it, because out of the 300 people invited to this free banquet, Mayor's paying for our dinner, so why not? Out of the 300, 230 signed up by the end of the evening, and they have the founding members of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. Now, the ironic thing is, given why we're here tonight, the ironic thing is that the idea of having a subcommittee for awards was an afterthought. I mean, you think, and that's why what the Academy is most known for these days is the Academy Award, but the awards subcommittee, that pretty much was an afterthought. I have here a picture of Douglas Fairbanks Sr. So he figured, you know, we should have sort of something akin really to Employee of the Month, I guess you could say, awards of merit for distinctive achievement. So the committee that was put together for the awards, seven people, and the subcommittee really didn't get anything accomplished for a good year. So the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences existed for a full year before they actually put together an official award, a nomination process, and you know how the whole thing would work. So one full year. So it took until 1928. And the reason why Louis B. Mayer finally gave the awards subcommittee some attention, I will let his own quotation speak for itself. He said, and I quote, "I found the best way to handle movie makers was to hang medals all over them. If I got them cups and awards, they'd kill themselves to produce what I wanted. That's why the Academy Award was created." Straight from Louis B. Mayer. How much of that is truth and how much of that is his own personal brand of fiction? Who knows? But the fact of the matter is that is a direct quote from him. I got it from a very fascinating biography of him. I recommend it highly. Lion of Hollywood, The Life and Legend of Louis B. Mayer, right there at the top of your screen. So basically for him, it was a matter of maintaining creative control. And that summer, July of 1928, when the Academy itself was 1 year old, a nomination process was put together and finalized, July of 1928. Cedric Gibbons, who designed the beach house, by the way, he was the same one who designed the statuette itself. Same guy, the art director of MGM. Now, here's the interesting thing, is that for the Academy Awards, for the first year they were given out, only silent films were eligible. On top of that, the eligibility period was different from what it is today. Today, it's a calendar year, January 1 of 2020 or through December 31st of 2020. Granted, because of the pandemic, they extended the eligibility period this year. But what I'm saying is January 1 to December 31, any given calendar year under normal circumstances. But for the first few years, the eligibility period was actually midsummer to midsummer, August 1 through the following July 31. So if you go and you Google first Academy Award winners, you will not see a single year listed next to the film title or next to the name of the recipient. You'll see 1927/28, 1928/29. It didn't go into calendar year until about 1930-31. So it didn't take long, but it was about 3 years or so when they had midsummer through midsummer. Now, the very first Academy Awards ceremony, you're not going to believe this, but it took about, I would say, maybe 5 to 10 minutes to hand all of the awards out, because once again, it was a they love their banquets. It was another banquet, this time at the Roosevelt in Hollywood. And it was certainly not the way that we understand the Academy Awards to be today. Because back then, for the first year at least, it was a formal dinner and dancing. The awards were not given out until the final 5-10 minutes of the evening. They waited until the end because they did not want any recipients to take their Oscar and then leave. They wanted them to stay the whole time. And not only that, but there were not a list. There were no lists of nominees the way there are today. The winners were all pre-announced a couple of months ahead of time. They were announced in March, in fact, in Variety. And the recipients received an invitation to the banquet. Congratulations, you are the first to receive our new Academy Award. The ceremony will be May 16th, save the date. And that's really the way it worked. So they would show up and they would be dressed to the nines. There would be dinner and dancing. They had little miniature chocolate replicas of the Oscars as the centerpieces on the table. So very different from what we associate the Academy Awards with these days. As far as the first Best Picture winner, Wings, a silent film, a World War I drama, and it stars Clara Bow, who was one of the biggest stars of the 1920s. So this was the first Best Picture winner, but at the top, for the first year, it was called Outstanding Picture, not Best. It was called Outstanding Picture. And there were actually two different categories for Picture. There was Outstanding Picture, which went to Wings, and there was also a different category, which was only that first year. They eliminated it after year one, and it was called Most Unique and Artistic Picture, and that went to a silent film called Sunrise. What you see right now is the program for the evening, including the menu. So this was the dinner they served at the first Academy Award ceremony: half-broiled chicken on toast, string beans, long branch potatoes, lettuce and tomatoes with French dressing, cakes, demi-tasse, et cetera. So that was the meal. That was the meal, and it was the second year that the Academy itself existed, even though it was the first year of the Academy Awards. And I mentioned already Wings and Sunrise. Here are the first acting winners. There were no supporting categories, not quite yet. There was just actor and actress, and here they are, Janet Gaynor and Emil Jannings. He looks very thrilled to be there. That was really his attitude. He was, in fact, the very first no-show at the ceremony. Year one, and they already had someone who refused to go. He was not a U.S. citizen. He came from Germany, and he wanted to hop on a plane and go home. And they said to him, come on, come to the ceremony. It'll be good for you. It'll be good for us. Good publicity. Get some pictures taken with you next to your award. But you have to remember, there was no precedent set. It wasn't like these people were saying, oh, wow, I have been working so long for this. I've always dreamed of this. I finally have an Academy Award. This was the first year. So a lot of people were looking at the statuette saying, funny looking man. And what's this award all about? And okay, thank you. So, so it was just a different dynamic. So they said to him, please, so he agreed, I guess you could call it a compromise, but he agreed to pose for a few pictures with his award. And once the flashes went off, he basically said, okay, can I go home now? They said, fine, go. He hopped on an airplane, flew home to Germany, and never returned to the United States for the remainder of his life. So that was the first Academy Award winner for Best Actor. You'll notice that for each of them, that I have several film titles listed next to their names. Again, it was done differently. Now you win an Oscar if you're an actor for a particular role in a particular film. For the first year, it was done differently. It was who had the most impressive body of work during the eligibility period, who acted in the most consistent quality, who basically consistently turned out quality performances in quality material, quality films. So that's how the actors were determined at first. There were plenty of honorary awards that first year as well. Even though it was the first year, as I mentioned, they already had their first no-show. In addition, there was already the morning after the first critic. And it was an MGM screenwriter. Her name was Frances Marion. If you have the ability, if you have the option to take a look at any, look her up, take a look at any of her stories, she was actually a very witty person. She, with scorn, the next day wrote up a little review of the ceremony saying, a little gold-washed statuette, she said, a little bit on the amateurish side, the perfect symbol of the picture business, a powerful athletic body clutching a gleaming sword with half of his head, that part which held his brains, completely sliced off. So basically, all brawn, no brains. You know, she was saying that's rather symbolic of the ceremony itself, you know, all glitter, but no substance. That was the way she saw it anyway. And indeed, take a look at the statuette, the way it's designed, the back part of the skull is not part of the design. Don't ask me why. I wish I knew. That's the way Cedric Gibbons designed it. If any of you know, please feel free to type it into the chat. In all of my research, I've never been able to find a reason for this particular design. All I can tell you is that he is standing, the base of it, this figure is standing on a reel of film, and that each spoke in the reel of film represents a different branch, acting, producing, directing, etc. And he's clutching this sword and sticking the point of the sword into the film reel. But as far as why the back part of the head is missing, I wish I could tell you. I mentioned already that there were no supporting categories. That lasted for about 10 years, or I should say, they would not be introduced until about 10 years later. 1937, so just shy of 10 years. In addition, the supporting recipients at first, they did not get an Academy Award statuette. They instead received a plaque. So that was discontinued in 1944, and they were given the option of returning the plaque, trading it in for the statuette. So supporting categories came about 10 years later, and for the first 7 years or so, they received plaques, not a statuette. In addition, children or child actors were not eligible to compete for Academy Awards at first, not at first. Judy Garland, she was 16 years old when she did The Wizard of Oz. She was not nominated for a competitive Oscar. By that point, there were lists of nominees in the so-called competition, but she was not nominated in a competitive category. Instead, she received a special recognition Oscar, which was given to child performers who gave exceptional performances. That was what was given to them at first. It was a little miniature Academy Award. And here it is right here. Mickey Rooney, her frequent co-star. He was the one to present her with the special recognition Oscar. And I mean, take a look at the size of that thing. I mean, his arm is bigger than the mini Oscar. So the question is really, is Judy Garland an Academy Award winner for The Wizard of Oz? And I guess it all depends on how you look at it. Yes, she received a miniature honorary Oscar. No, she was not nominated in a competitive category. So, like I said, it really is all a matter of perspective and how you look at it. She never felt that she actually received an Academy Award. She had been nominated for A Star Is Born in 1954, and she was widely expected to win. And in a surprise upset, it went to Grace Kelly for The Country Girl. She was then nominated later on in 1961 for Judgment at Nuremberg. And that year, it went to Rita Moreno for West Side Story. So she never won a competitive Academy Award. Peggy Ann Garner, another child actress from 1945's A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. She received the Special Recognition Child Performer Award. Here she is posing with it right here. That was 1945. So That gives you the basic story. I mean, I could go on with more details about how and why the Oscar exists and how categories were introduced, but I think now I am looking at the time, and I think now would be a good time to begin to tell you about some famous as well as infamous moments from these ceremonies over the years. One of the very first, what I call the oops moments, or the Homer Simpson dough moments. It was year number six. It was 1933. Will Rogers was the host that year, and he was presenting Best Director. And what happened was there were two director nominees who had the same first name, Frank, my name, and Frank Capra and Frank Lloyd. And Will Rogers was good friends with, he was good friends with Frank Lloyd. So when he opened up the envelope and you know, he saw his friend's name and he said excitedly, "Come on up and get it, Frank." And the wrong Frank got up. Frank Capra stood up and he was wondering why the spotlight wasn't coming over to him. He waved, didn't come over to him. He bounded onto the stage. He made it to the stage, to the podium. And Will Rogers was probably standing there saying, little awkward. Yeah, go back to your seat, not you. And Frank Lloyd came up. So an embarrassing moment, certainly not one that I would want to experience, but so we don't all feel too bad for Frank Capra, I should mention that he would later go on to host the Oscars twice. He would go on to win three times, and he also served as the Academy president for 4 years. So he did quite all right in the end. In fact, the three Best Director Oscars that he would go on to win, the first of those three was the very next year, 1934. In 1934, his sweet victory, it happened one night. This is the first of three films, three so far anyway, but this is the first of three films to win in the top five categories: Best Picture and Director, Best Leading Actor and Actress, and Best Screenplay. Does anybody happen to know what the other two were? So It Happened One Night was the first. The second would not happen until decades later. And then the third, a couple of decades after that. The only three films to sweep the top five categories. And again, in Hollywood speak, in Oscar speak, the leading actor, Oscar, leading actress is apparently more of an achievement than supporting. I think it's just as much of an achievement to win supporting, but in terms of the hierarchy, the top five categories, I'm looking in the chat, no guesses. Well, the second of the three films, Silence of the Lambs, yes. Silence of the Lambs was actually the third and most recent, 1991. Anthony Hopkins and Jodie Foster won the two acting awards, Best Picture, Best Director, Best Screenplay. Oh, not as good as it gets. As good as it gets did get leading actor and actress for Jack Nicholson and Helen Hunt, but it didn't sweep the top five. That was the same year as Titanic, actually, so that pretty much fills in the blanks there as far as what the other category winners were. So in addition to It Happened One Night and Silence of the Lambs, the second of the three to sweep the top five, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest with Jack Nicholson and Louise Fletcher. And the miniature Oscar for the child performance, 1934, it went that year to a child actress who warmed many a heart during the Great Depression era, and that of course is Shirley Temple. Now, she was 6 years old when she received this Oscar, so the Oscar is practically just as tall as she is, the miniature one. So she was 6 years old. She did nine movies in 1934 alone, and that is Claudette Colbert, the Oscar-winning star, the newly minted Oscar-winning best actress from It Happened One Night. So big night for the two of them. 1939 saw a year when there was a lot going on. For one thing, it was the year of Gone with the Wind, and Gone with the Wind set a record, which has since been broken, but at the time it set a record for the most number of Oscar wins for one film, and it was eight. It was also the year where we had the first African-American performer win an Academy Award. That was Hattie McDaniel. She won supporting. She won supporting for Gone with the Wind. And this was also the year, I'll just basically tell you that the Los Angeles Times had obtained a copy of the list of the recipients, the winners, that night. They received that list before the ceremony began. I can only guess it was to get a jump on the competition, but they went ahead and they published the list of winners in their evening edition. So there were people on their way to the Academy Awards ceremony, probably sitting there in their limos, reading the evening edition of the Los Angeles Times and finding out right then and there whether or not they won, or at least finding out who won, who would go on to win that evening. Needless to say, the Academy was not too pleased, and that is why, to this day, the envelope is sealed and it's top secret until the envelope is opened live on air. And that was because of what happened in 1939. I do have here Hattie McDaniel's acceptance speech, and we do have enough time for it. It's relatively quick. It is a piece of Oscar history, and I'd like to play that for you now. So this is Hattie McDaniel receiving her plaque. Don't forget, she won in the supporting category, so receiving her plaque for Gone with the Wind, being introduced by Faye Bainter, who had won supporting actress the previous year.
I'm really especially happy that I'm chosen to present this particular plaque. To me, it seems more than just a plaque of gold. It opens the doors of this room, moves back the walls, and enables us to embrace the whole of America, an America that we love, an America that, almost alone in the world today, recognizes and pays tribute to those who give of their best, regardless of creed, race, or color. It is with the knowledge that this entire nation will stand and salute the presentation of this plaque that I present the Academy Award for the best performance of an actress in supporting role during 1939, to Hattie McDaniel.
Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Science, fellow members of the motion picture industry, and honored guests. This is one of the happiest moments of my life, and I want to thank each one of you who had a part in selecting me for one of the awards. For your kindness, it has made me feel very, very humble, and I shall always hold it as a beacon for anything that I may be able to do in the future. I sincerely hope I shall always be a credit to my race and to the motion picture industry. My heart is too full to tell you just how I feel. And may I say thank you. God bless you.
So, historic moment right there for the Academy Awards. That was early 1940 for the 1939 Oscars.
I'm really.
All right. Well, I do feel it's also appropriate to mention this. December of 1941, we all know what happened, of course, the attack on Pearl Harbor. So that, of course, led to United States involvement in World War II. And, you know, not unlike the Oscar ceremony 20 years ago after 9/11, there was some questioning, you know, what is the most graceful, what is the most appropriate, the most tasteful, respectful way to proceed? Do we cancel? Do we tone it down? What is the proper direction to go in for the Oscars this year? Now, the Academy president at this point was none other than Betty Davis. She was the first woman president of the Academy, and she had only been president for a couple of weeks. She was only president for a couple of weeks, and what happened was she had the idea, her suggestion, that she brought to the Board of Governors. She said, why don't we open up the ceremony to the public? The public can buy tickets to attend, and then all proceeds from ticket sales will donate to war relief efforts. So that was her suggestion. The Board of Governors, not too keen on that particular idea, and they shot it down. And Betty Day, for her, that was just the latest in a long series of what she saw as slights and slaps in the face and, you know, sexism. And so she ultimately did resign. She resigned after only being president for a few weeks, in fact. So it was a very brief tenure. She said she was done with being the, quote, figurehead president. That was how she put it. And she said, you know, if they're not even gonna, why bother? Basically. So ultimately what ended up happening with the Oscars that year, there was no dancing, there was no formal wear, and those who attended, they were asked to make donations voluntarily to the Red Cross. So that was the direction that they went in. The following year, 1942, began a series of World War II themed films that would win Best Picture. 1942, the classic Mrs. Miniver would win Best Picture. It would also win Best Leading Actress for Greer Garson and Best Supporting Actress for Teresa Wright. Teresa Wright, she's in the middle. As you can see, there she is holding her plaque. Now, Greer Garson, she gave an acceptance speech that to this day remains in the records for being the longest, 5.5 minutes. The Oscars for a few years during the war years were made out of plaster because the material was needed for the war. And something that's not war related, just an amusing little anecdote, Irving Berlin was nominated for Best Song, the song in question, White Christmas. And he was asked to present an Oscar. He said, great, yeah, sure. And they said, great, you can present the Oscar for Best Song. For some reason, nobody thought that that might make for a potentially awkward moment. I'm presenting the Oscar in the category that I'm myself nominated in. So he opened up the envelope and it was his own name that he saw. So he said, and the Oscar goes to me. And he was he made a joke into the microphone saying, I couldn't have gone to a nicer fella. So White Christmas did win the Academy Award for Best Song. And it was received by the presenter, Irving Berlin. What can be said that hasn't already been said about Casablanca? It won Best Picture in 1943. This was the year, the Casablanca year, was the year when the supporting winners were told, you can trade in your plaques if you want the actual statuettes. And so some did, some didn't. But an amusing story here for you. Barry Fitzgerald, he won supporting actor for Going My Way with Bing Crosby. He was practicing his golf swing with his plaster Oscar in his living room, and he beheaded the thing by accident. So makes for a great photo. The studio, Paramount, they did pay for a replacement for gold. Once the war ended, anybody who won a plaster Oscar could trade it in for the gold one. So Paramount did pay for him to replace his broken plaster one with the gold one once the war ended. Barry Fitzgerald also created, I should say his situation regarding his nomination and his win, that created a little bit of controversy that put into place a rule that exists to this day. You cannot be nominated more than once for the same performance. He was so determined to win an Oscar that he submitted his name, or his people submitted his name for consideration in both the leading and in the supporting categories. So when the nominations were announced, he was nominated twice. He and Bing Crosby competed for Best Leading Actor for the same film that they did together, Going My Way. And Barry Fitzgerald was nominated a second time for the same film, same performance in the supporting category. So the Academy the following year put in the rule that, you can't do that. Choose one category or the other, and that's the one that that you'll push for. 1946 saw the Oscar going to Best Years of Our Lives. Now, I want to point out this film in terms of Oscar history because Harold Russell became the only actor to receive two Oscars for the same role. One was a special recognition and one was Best Supporting Actor. He was a real life World War II veteran and he had lost his hands in North Carolina when he was in training. It was an explosion and he lost his hands. And so the Navy, they fitted him with these hooks. And these hooks he used for the rest of his life. And so they had him do sort of a short promotional film that would play before the feature presentations in the movie theaters. And long story short, Best Years of Our Lives was put into production and his role was written expressly for him. His character too has the hooks for the hands. And so because that was his real life situation, he won Best Supporting Actor and he was given special recognition for bringing hope and courage to his fellow veterans. So that was the only time, and presumably it will remain the only time when someone will win two Oscars for the same role, the same performance. Just to sort of sum up the next couple of decades, the Academy Awards were aired on television for the first time in March of 53 for the 52 Oscars. The Gone with the Wind record of 8 wins was broken by Ben-Hur with 11 wins in 1959. That has only been matched twice, Titanic and Return of the King. And in 1960, Shirley Temple, who was now of course grown up, she presented the final miniature Oscar to child actress Disney princess Haley Mills. The Academy decided that year, we're going to discontinue the miniature Oscar for child performers, and child performers will now be eligible to compete for an Academy Award. And it did not take long before Mary Badham would be nominated for playing Scout in To Kill a Mockingbird, and Patty Duke would win for playing Helen Keller in The Miracle Worker. The decade later, you would see Linda Blair nominated for The Exorcist and Tatum O'Neill win for Paper Moon. A few years after that, you had Justin Henry nominated for Kramer versus Kramer. So that, as of 1961, became a possibility for all of them. Now, fast forward to the end of the 1960s, and you have a very turbulent time in US history. Well, global history, really, but speaking strictly in terms of US history, it was Oscar's 42nd year, and this really was a pivotal turning point in pop culture. I mean, we now, you know, the Beatles came in and Elvis was out and the Beatles were in. And of course, at this point you had Woodstock and you had the countercultural movement and you had the civil rights movement and, you know, the Vietnam protests and, you know, new generation with a new explanation, just like in that song, right? So it took Hollywood movies a while to catch up with changing audience tastes. But in 1969, the first and only X-rated movie would win Best Picture, and that would be Midnight Cowboy. And what cracks me up is that the other cowboy to win that year could not be any more opposite to the spirit of counterculture revolution, because John Wayne would win leading actor for True Grit, his one and only Oscar win. So it was the year, I call it the year of the cowboy, but two very different kinds of cowboys. And just a reflection of how, you know, the old and the new, you know, were sort of coming together. And that was really the beginning of it. I mean, 2 years earlier, you had The Graduate and Bonnie and Clyde and Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and In the Heat of the Night. They were nominated alongside Dr. Doolittle with Rex Harrison. So 1967 probably can more accurately be referred to as the year when there was the cultural shift. But for Midnight Cowboy, an X-rated movie to win, 1969, I would say, was what finally cemented it. Best actor acceptance speeches over the years. Well, in the early 1970s, we had a couple of memorable no-shows. George C. Scott would win his Oscar for Patton in 1970. He had no interest in attending. He had no interest in the Academy Awards, referring to the ceremony as, and I quote, a meat market. And so he said he would be home the night of the Oscars watching golf on TV. And that's exactly what he did. And so when Goldie Hawn opened the envelope and saw his name, as you can see here, she just started laughing. And she says, oh my God, George C. Scott. And the film's producer accepted the award on Scott's behalf. On the right-hand side, there was less laughter and more tension when Marlon Brando was announced as the recipient of Best Leading Actor for The Godfather. He was not there. Everyone knew he was not there. He had given his ticket to a young woman who identified herself as Sasheen Littlefeather at the podium. He gave her a speech to read. You know, should I win? This is what I want you to say. And so she delivered a speech on behalf of Native American rights. And there was some boos and there was some applause. And she read the speech in full to the press afterwards. She was threatened with being arrested for trespassing if she was on the stage for longer than 1 minute. So it did create some tension, but that was in 1972 for the first Godfather, for Marlon Brando. Now, someone in the chat earlier typed in Sally Fields saying, "You like me." Well, I have here the clip for you to enjoy. Acceptance speeches from the heart, I call it. 1984. Now, Sally Fields, we love her. Sally Fields started out as a teenage actress, Gidget, the Flying Nun, and that's what she meant when she said, "I haven't had an orthodox career." She received an Emmy in the mid-1970s for a television movie that she did called Sybil, well-earned, and she won her first Academy Award for Norma Rae in 1979. However, she still did not feel that she was respected by the film industry. She still did not feel that she was being taken seriously. So when she was announced as the winner in 1984, her second Academy Award win, you know, was this a moment of her exposing her vulnerabilities? Was this a moment of her putting her foot in her mouth? Was this a moment of her just baring her soul? Hey, opinions vary. I will, however, say that she herself has made fun of herself for this over the years. It is one of the most remembered Oscar speeches ever, probably because it's also been parodied. It's been parodied in commercials and sitcoms. Sally Field herself did a commercial. Don't ask me what it was for. I don't remember if it was for a car insurance, life insurance. I could not say home insurance. It was a commercial for something. And the premise of the commercial is that she's walking down the city sidewalk, and she's talking to the camera, and she's, you know, saying everything about whatever it is that she was selling. And the running gag throughout the commercial is that people keep stopping her to tell her, "Yo, Sally Fields, I like you. I really, really like you." And that happens several times throughout the whole commercial. So she maintains a good sense of humor about it. So, but here is the clip. For those of you who have never seen it, for those of you who remember seeing it, and for those of you who would like to see it again.
"And I can't deny the fact that you like me
right now. So people did applaud. There was no booing. A couple of people looked like they were saying to themselves, "Okay, it's at this point where we stop liking you." But she's respected in Hollywood still. I mean, she got nominated a third time for Lincoln in 2012. So I think she's doing just fine. I'm seeing here in the chat, Midnight Cowboy. It was X-rated, but it was later re-rated, and it was downgraded to an R rating after its initial release. But at the time of its Oscar win, it was X-rated still. Roberto Benigni, one of my favorite Oscar moments ever. He received, his film, Life is Beautiful, would receive 3 awards: Best Musical Score, Best Foreign Language Film, and Best Leading Actor. And I am noticing the time, so I am going to play this clip, but I'll probably stop it short, just to give you a little taste, a little memory of just how excited he was.
And the Oscar goes to Roberto.
This is Italy's 26th nomination and its 10th Academy Award.
So that was Roberto Benigni winning for Life is Beautiful. And I don't know about you, but if my name were announced as the recipient of an Academy Award, maybe I'd jump on top of the back of Steven Spielberg's chair myself. I mean, who knows? You never know until you're in that moment, right? James Cameron, 1997, Titanic. He personally would win 3 of those films' 11 Oscars because he edited it, he directed it, and he was one of the producers. He asked for a moment of silence to honor the real life victims of the Titanic tragedy. And then he awkwardly broke that moment of silence. He gave it a little bit of time, but then he broke the silence by saying into the microphone, let's go party till dawn. This, of course, was after he declared himself king of the world when he won Best Director. 2001, history was made. This was Oscar's 74th year. Halle Berry became the first African-American woman to win in the leading category for Monsters Ball. Denzel Washington, he became the first two-time winner. He had won previously in the supporting category for Glory, and then he won leading for Training Day. 2001 was also the year when they introduced a new category that we still have now, Best Animated Feature. And the very first Best Animated Feature winner, the original Shrek, with the voices of Mike Myers, Eddie Murphy, Cameron Diaz, and John Lithgow. 2009, Kathryn Bigelow became the first and to date, the only female Best Director winner for The Hurt Locker. Ironically, one of her co-nominees that year was her ex-husband, James Cameron, for Avatar. Will Chloe Zhao for Nomadland join Kathryn Bigelow in the list of female director winners? You know, we'll find out on Sunday night. But at least as of right now, Kathryn Bigelow is the only woman, the only female Best Director winner so far, at least. 2011, Academy Award history came full circle. And I say that because for the first time in all of those years, the Best Picture winner was a silent picture. If you remember The Artist released in 2011, starring Jean Desjardins. It was about a silent film actor who was struggling to maintain his career once the talkies entered the picture, no pun intended. So it's a great film, it really is. That was 2011. 2013, John Travolta famously said Idina Menzel's name wrong. Idina Menzel, Broadway sensation, singer, actress Idina Menzel, the voice of Queen Elsa in Disney's Frozen. She sang the song, Let It Go. Perhaps you've heard it once or twice. John Travolta was introducing Idina Menzel because she was about to perform the song. And I don't know what happened, but he mispronounced her name as Adele Dazeem.
Gorgeously empowering song, Let It Go, from the Oscar-winning animated movie Frozen. Please welcome the wickedly talented one and only Adele Dazeem.
A moment that left people looking at each other saying, who? And saying, oh, was Idina Menzel last minute get sick or something? Was she like replaced at the last minute by somebody else? But no, 3 seconds later, it sure enough was Idina Menzel singing the song. So Ellen DeGeneres was the host that year. So in the way that only Ellen can, after the song ended, she just very loudly enunciated the name Idina Menzel several times into the microphone. That was Idina Menzel, everybody, Idina Menzel. So that was, but I will say this, it became a big joke. Idina Menzel, to her credit, had a very good attitude about the whole thing. In fact, she said, I owe John Travolta a lot, she said, because if it weren't for this kind of thing, you know, becoming, you know, one of the stories of the evening, she said, not everybody would know who I am. She says, now more people than ever know my name, so I really should thank them. And if you think about it, yeah, that's actually kind of a good point. So she took it all in stride. And the two of them together, he sent her a whole bunch of flowers and an apology note. The following year, Travolta and Menzel together co-presented Best Song. And the host that year was Neil Patrick Harris. And so the whole thing was turned into a joke. And I will just let it speak for itself.
Benedict Cumberbatch. It's not only the most awesome name in show business, it's also the sound you get when you ask John Travolta to pronounce Ben Affleck.
Please welcome to the stage my very dear friend, Glom Gazingo.
I deserve that, but you, my darling, my beautiful, my wickedly talented Idina Menzel.
You got it!
Is that right?
So it turned into a good moment the following year. So that was a moment. Okay. Well, that brings us to really the end of the, I'm taking a look at the time. It's 8:15, so okay, good timing. I leave you with this question. How will Best Picture be announced this year? Because there is no way we can talk about memorable moments from the Oscars without referring to early 2017 for the 16 Oscars. La La Land received the Academy Award for Best Picture for about, maybe a minute when it was discovered that it was the wrong envelope. Now, what actually happened was there are two copies of every envelope. And two sets of the envelopes with the lists of the names of the winners in them. And each set is on the opposite side of the stage. So stage right, stage left. And representatives from the accounting firm that tallies up all of the ballots, there is one representative stationed throughout the entire show behind the curtains in each wing. And they're the ones responsible for giving the right envelope to the right presenter. And depending on which side of the stage the presenter will come out. So what ended up happening was the person who was in charge of giving Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway the Best Picture envelope wasn't paying attention. And actually, because he was too busy, from what I read anyway, Emma Stone had just won Best Actress for La La Land. He was too busy taking pictures of her backstage with his phone. And so he was distracted, his mind was not on his work. And so when Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway walked past him onto the stage, he gave them the wrong envelope. He gave them the Best Actress envelope. So Warren Beatty opened the envelope, hesitated, handed it to Faye Dunaway. And even though Warren Beatty is the one who is accused of, you know, making the mistake, it was Faye Dunaway who actually said La La Land into the microphone. So cast and crew of La La Land, they got onto the stage and the acceptance speeches are going. Meanwhile, the stagehands are going frantic. You can see it right here, the running behind, you know, whispers, you know, out of the mic range. Everyone's saying to each other, how do we handle this? What do we do? Emma Stone saying, oh my God. Once it was confirmed what actually happened, the producer of La La Land graciously said, Moonlight, I'm happy to give you this award. So the Moonlight cast and crew then got onto the stage, and Warren Beatty said into the microphone, I was not trying to be funny. He said, I opened up the envelope and it said Emma Stone, La La Land. So he was given the second copy of the Best Actress envelope. So that's actually what happened. But Moonlight got its time in the spotlight. I love the look on Meryl Streep's face here. She is, you know, right here on the far right. Meryl Streep, Ben Affleck, Michelle Williams, The Rock. You see them all looking with astonishment and horror because this was unprecedented. So I do have here a closing montage of all of the Best Picture winners over the years, and I do hope you enjoy this. Again, please join me on all of the any or all of these social media platforms. I will be posting information about my upcoming podcast. I will leave it visible while I play for you this montage of Best Picture winners over the years.
Frank, can you pause that for 1 second?
Absolutely.
So folks, before Frank plays the montage, I would encourage people to get their questions into the Q&A so we can seamlessly transition into questions once Frank is done playing this video. So we're gonna try to wrap by 8:30. I wanna give you at least 5 to 10 minutes of questions. So if you have questions, make sure to get them into the Q&A. All right, Frank, you can press the button.
Okay, here we go. Thank you.
Thank you.
So Frank, thanks for showing the montage there. It's definitely something on my end. I probably have a box that I need to check or something, but the sound was going in and out for me a little bit. We had similar experience with Ty Burr last week, so I think it's you and not me. Let's get to a few questions before we wrap up. First of all, I just had awful flashbacks. I saw Birdman there, and I got to tell you, Frank, so we show film screenings, we did show film screenings at my library quite frequently, weekly, really. And I showed, always try to show the Oscar films, and showed Birdman a couple years ago, right around the time it was released on DVD. And I have never had a worse reaction to a critically acclaimed film than I did with Birdman. I had about 100 people in the audience and no one got it. Everyone hated the film. So we'll start with that. Okay, so Mark wants to know, how did the Oscars get its name?
Okay. Here's the honest to God truth. There is nothing confirmed. There are several different stories that are out there, and each of them probably has some degree of truthfulness to them. One story is that one of the Academy secretaries took a look at the statuette and is said to have commented, "Goodness, he looks just like my Uncle Oscar." That's one story that's out there. Another story that's out there is that Betty Davis claims that the, how can I put this? She said that the rear end of the statuette reminded her of her husband's at the time. And so Oscar was his middle name. So she claims that she was the one to have gotten that nickname going. So is there truthfulness to both of those stories? Probably, as far as, you know, which one is the official story. There really is no official story that the Academy has confirmed, but those are both the most publicized.
Catherine asks, thoughts on the absolutely ridiculous proposal to have an achievement in popular film category several years ago?
Oh, Lord. All I can say is thank God they did not do that. That's like basically saying, all right, from their viewpoint, I can understand what their goal was. Their goal was to increase viewership. That was their goal. And, you know, because viewership, when you have a year, much like this year, to be honest, when you have a year where there really isn't a film that is a big box office hit, you don't have a film that really has, you know, caught on, people aren't going to tune in because, or at least they'll be less likely to tune in because they're films that they haven't even seen. And why sit through a 3.5 hour long TV show where awards are being given out for films or for performances or for screen plays or for costumes, makeup, I mean, pick a category, for a film you're not even familiar with. So I can understand that that was their goal, to increase TV viewership. As far as the creation of a category for most popular film, I agree completely. That was ill-conceived. Rewarding a film basically for how much money it makes, not on its merit.
Elena says, excellent evening at the Oscars, Frank and Robert. Thank you so much. Frank did all the work, Elena. Elena does have a question. She says, why didn't Denzel Washington win Best Actor for Fences? He was beyond brilliant in that. It was such an important role with such an important theme and message, an absolutely hugely challenging role. Any thoughts on any recent snubs, including Denzel?
Well, Fences is actually a play that I've taught for about 20 years. So I was very familiar with the complexities of the role he played, the character, before the film was even made. The fact that Denzel did not receive the Oscar that year, I do think is a shame because he deserved it. Casey Affleck won that year for Manchester by the Sea. And Denzel did receive the Screen Actors Guild that year for Fences. So it was one of those situations where it's, you know, it looked like it was a very strong possibility. As far as why it didn't turn out, I mean, I guess only the voters would be able to answer that, but I personally would have given it to Denzel.
So Frank, I don't see any other comments or questions into the chat, and we went a full 90 minutes, so that's wonderful. And it looks like most of the audience stuck with us. Do you have any last words for the group before we wrap up?
All I can say is, you know, keep watching movies. It's the arts that keep the human spirit alive. And I know that sounds corny. I know it sounds cliched, and I know it sounds funny as anything, but I truly do believe that. So yes, it's been a difficult time that we're continuing to go through, but keep the human spirit alive. The arts is a great way of doing that, whether it's movies, whether it's music, photography, poetry, sculpture, painting, whatever it may be, any form of expression, just, you know, keep it going. And support local movie theaters.
Great. Well, I hope everyone watches the Oscars this Sunday from 8 to 11. You can probably, I think the pre-show starts around 6, and you know, we'll see if it actually ends at 11. Some years it goes to 11:30, it seems. But anyway, I hope everyone enjoyed tonight. I hope everyone enjoys Oscar night. I want to thank Frank so much. And everyone, look for an email from me tomorrow morning with a link to a feedback survey. Let us know what you thought of tonight's event and what you'd like to see for future events. I want to thank the Andover Library for co-sponsoring with Tewksbury tonight. And I hope everyone has a great rest of their evening. Thanks again, Frank.
Thank you. Thank you all. Have a great night. Take care.
Have a good one, everyone. Bye-bye.